line makes your life that much easier, right? And when you have a Camille, you're mainly going to be setting up for a 1-4. And 4-1 comps are a little bit harder to execute because of how well you have to control the side lane wave. So maybe they'll be forced to send the Corki there, which is okay, but then you've always got that risk of how much easier it is for Ryze to move from one lane to another. So
It's the balance of Realm Warp and package, really, isn't it? Trying to work out exactly how you are going to play those translations, those rotations across the map. And I think it's actually going to be quite interesting to see, because Kinguin first week really didn't look like they had that level of communication that you need for a strong 1-4. We are straight on to the Summoner's Rift, though, for our first game of the day. Kinguin versus the Misfits Academy. Misfits, of course, now with their new jungler, really want to focus down on how Pridestalker plays this Kha'Zix and how impactful he can be, because he's replacing Kadir, who had an incredible week one.
He's also going up against Tabasku, who, during the Challenger Series qualifiers, was more of the aggressive playmaker. He did go more towards champions like Lee Sin, which he was well known for. He synergized nicely with Ice Bisto. And now we see both these players on carry-centric junglers, more about aggression, more about snowballing and getting ahead. So if you are Tabasco, what I'd like you to do is invest a lot more of your time into the top half of the map. This could obviously put Woolite and Delord at a bit of a deficit, especially when you look at the wave clear they have from the Varus, who's naturally very good at pushing, and the pick potential and bush control that Dreams does have with the Thresh. It's going to be a little bit difficult for the Kinguin's bottom lane, but if they can make up for it by snowballing that Camille, it'll definitely make up for it.
It feels very much like Kinguin have said, we need to get this Camille ahead, we need to get our lanes ahead, and picking Corki in the mid lane, incredibly safe, very easy just to play out the laning phase. Their bot lane as well is a relatively safe bot lane, although there is a lot of pick potential, as you say. A lot of Tabasco's focus has to be up towards that top side of the map, trying to work out exactly how he can get Ice Bisto snowballing into a Shen matchup.
Well, the fact that he started off top side will be interesting.
Level 2 gank?
Level 2 with a blue buff? Gamble.
Yeah, it's a massive gamble, but it does seem very odd, as you say, for him to start here because his rotation through his jungle naturally takes him down towards the bottom
lane. Well, this is why we'll track Tabasco's path as he makes his way through the jungle. He may very well look for an early gank bot. I'd be very surprised if he chose to gank mid lane, given that it's a Corki Ryze matchup. He may be able to burn a flash, which means that it makes it harder for KozQ to push out the wave and look for roams, as Delord being a bit aggressive in the bottom lane.
Yeah, already getting good harass down onto Dreams, though, and this is what you need to do. Thresh, because he's so low mobility when he tries to land that hook, he isolates himself. You can catch him out, and you can continue to try and harass him down.
And a lot of it also comes from Delord being able to get early bush priority. So the fact that he could move up, Dreams had already used his Flay early on. That's a pretty long cooldown that Delord then just abused with his passive. Remember that the passive did get buffed ever so slightly on patch 7.2, so Delord making good use of that. Now, I wanted to talk a little bit about Tabasco and his early jungle clear. At the moment, he's just done a full topside clear, and as a jungler, if you are to do this, this is something that we saw Amazing do in one of his LCS games, where he cleared topside, he then completely avoided the Scuttle Crab, went through behind the jungle, and just went for a very early gank top. The difference was he was playing Elise, he had that crowd control, whereas Tabasco on this Lee Sin is just primarily clearing out as much of his jungle as he can. And this is surprising to me because he's gained no river control.
Nemex will get away, uses the cleanse here as well because they knew Pridestalker was near that bottom side river. And because of the way KozQ path, he actually went through Fog of War and was able to come back around the side of the mid lane.
I'm wondering what Tabasco's logic is right now, because I feel that you should be willing to either fight for a Scuttlecrab or at least gain control of at least one Scuttlecrab, right? Because it's such valuable early vision that you should either path in a way that if you clear full topside, then just go up to the river, clear the Scuttlecrab, and then get your red a little bit later, right? Or you do blue, wolves, and then you go to red, and then you make your way back up, clear Scuttle, and then you look for a path top. Because now, Kha'Zix having gone to red. Ooh, gank mid.
Yeah, Sebek's gonna get caught out. He's been exhausted as well. Here comes Tabasco, saves his mid laner. KozQ gets the kill with the auto. Teleport coming in from Kinguin, though, and Tabasco trades it. Here's Ice Bisto. Wall jump, grapples in. Pridestalker caught unawares by this TP. Ice Bisto gets the kill and gets the double buffs.
The play initially looked bad for Team Kinguin, but the collapse from Tabasco, followed by the teleport from Ice Bisto, is enough to actually turn the gank in Team Kingwin's favor. Getting themselves two kills and getting a double buff onto this Camille is going to be massive later on into the game. So notice that Kozku, he used the root onto Sebex as he overstepped. There's no mana on top of Sebex, so there's no way that he can get out of this situation. Tabasco being level 4 and against a Ryze is easily able to pick up the kill. Pridestalker had already used all of his cooldowns and summoner spells to get the initial kill onto Corki, which means that once Bisto has TP'd in, there is no room for him to escape. We talked about this top lane being a point that needed to snowball, and while there was no initial gank from Tabasco, Ice Bisto has been able to get himself his own lead.
I mean, getting a double buff when you're pushing into that Shen before he's able to get, you know, Tiamat or Titanic Hydra, any of that wave clear, would just allow Ice Bisto to continually force that wave up towards the turret, maybe look for those like ganks in the mid lane. You've got so much mobility on the Camille with the wall jump and the grapple. It's going to be exciting for the next couple of minutes for Kingwin if they're able to utilize the advantage that they have now gained.
It's horrible for Jisoo, though, because yeah. As a Shen who wants to look to make those cross-map plays, maybe set up a dive early in the bottom, it becomes really difficult. And because of how low he is, now Tabasco can look for a dive top.
And it's delaying his six as well. There's a big wave pushing in. Jisoo has to back because of the fact that Tabasco could come in for the gank. And Jisoo now goes back, teleports back in. We'll get some of that wave, but delaying having that stand united up is big. Kozku caught out, has no summoners, of course. And here comes Sebex for the chase. Kozku tries to get away. Pridestalker coming in. Will be able to get there, but not in time to save Kozku. Pridestalker's now dead as well. Tabasco on this Lee Sin is making waves.
Good punish from Tabasco to catch Kozku out of position. Instantly goes to the collapse with the immediate follow from Sebex. Enables them to get the initial kill onto Kozku. Now, all he's doing is getting a bit of vision. That's all he wants. He doesn't think he's in the wrong. He doesn't expect Tabasco to be behind him. Tabasco early on had already passed to the top side, which enabled him to come through the jungle. And Pridestalker, I think, should have just left his teammate to die. He tried to salvage a situation which was not in his favor, and he ends up giving a second kill. And now look at Tabasco, level 5, 3 kills, 1 assist, already completed that Caulfield's Warhammer. He has one powerful Lee Sin right now.
I just want to bring us back a little bit to picks and bans as well. And I know a lot of this game has been played around the jungle, but you talked about push priority in the bottom lane. You talked about safe early laners for misfits. That doesn't seem to be how this game is going. It's been all Kingwin thus far.
A lot of it has been due to the mistakes of Pridestalker, in part. Committing so much to getting a kill onto Sebex was a mistake. Simply because if you get his fort, if you get his flash and you realize that the jungler is mid, at that point you just have to concede and be like, okay, we didn't get the kill, but we've got all of his summoners, we can look to make a play later on into the game. At the very least, we have push priority mid, and we can now move into the enemy jungle, because Sebex cannot go past that safety line of his turret, right? Instead, they hard commit to the kill. They don't respect the potential collapse from Kingwin. And that's where you really have to praise Bisto for his quick response, because a lot of top laners won't immediately think, I'm going to TP into the mid lane at level 4, right? And the fact that he was able to do that demonstrates that this is more of what we see from Team Kingwin during the Challenger Series qualifiers.
Definitely. The communication seems to be there. They understand when they want to make plays and how they want to do it. And it's almost an instinctual level. That TP came in as soon as the gank started, as soon as they knew they might need a bit of assistance. And having the Camille, who is so mobile as well early game, really helps them out with that.
It really does. Now the question is, what can Team Kingwin do with this lead? Because they have a big advantage accruing in the top lane, given that Ice Bisto does have his Tiamat already fully completed. Tabasco is now level 6. He's completed his jungle item entirely, and this is where you need to keep the pressure on. You need to look to maybe set up a TP play bot. The teleport is now available for Ice Bisto. Maybe they can look to make a play around Dragon. A lot of summoners have returned for the side of Misfits, but just because of that, that shouldn't stop you from trying to force these plays.
You were mentioning, though, in picks and bans that the ability for Misfits to react is pretty good as well. You've got Realm Warp, you've got Stand United. Is there not a risk if Kingwin go for that teleport gank in bot lane that they are just going to lose out because of the quick reactions from Misfits?
But even if Misfits react this early on into the game, there's too big of a lead for Kingwin, where if it was a straight up 4v4, Kingwin would win, right? Well, especially when you compare the junglers, like, just look at the item difference. If you have Tabasco in that 4v4 fight versus Pridestalker, I'll put my money on the Lee Sin. especially like Ryze and Shen this early on into the game as well. This is the prime opportunity for Kingwin to force things, and it's nice to see them moving with the bottom lane or with the Delord and Sebex to push their vision line up. They have good control over where Pride Stalker is and playing around that. And look at Koskyu now. He's completely forced away from the wave because he is so paranoid of the possible dive coming out from Tabasco, and this is the sort of pressure that you want to be seeing from Kingwin.
Great stuff by Kingwin. Misfits Academy are going for those slow scaling items as well. Looks like it's going to be a Rod of Ages for Koskyu alongside that tier. We've got a tier finished on Yuki as well. Bot lane hasn't been the focus in this game, but still, it means that Misfits are delaying their power. Koskyu steps forward, doesn't quite get caught by Tabasco, but Spidey sense is there for Koskyu. That's all that saved him.
That could have very nearly gone wrong for Koskyu. Fortunately for him, he was able to sidestep the Q. Could also argue that Tabasco missed it, but we'll just give the praise to Koskyu.
It was a good step. Like, you can't know that's going to happen. You've cleared the bush. You know there's nothing there. You can't expect him to sidestep like that. But maybe you should do. Maybe that's the difference between winning and losing games at this level, the ability to read your opponent.
Maybe. I wouldn't know.
Just hypothesizing, anyway.
Just hypothesizing. Well, now I'm looking at... I'm mainly looking at that dragon and thinking, ah, those teams aren't going to want to fight for that, are they?
If it was an Infernal or a Mountain, we would probably see that four-man play in the bottom lane, but now it's much more on Kingwin to set up the play. And actually something we criticized them for in week one was their inability to make plays without telegraphing what they were doing. Here, they need to work around vision control. They need to understand that the enemy can react. They are going to get the Drake, which is great for them, but really, this is just taking this so they can see what the next one's going to be.
But this is a clean take of an objective, right? Because earlier on, we had seen them set up vision around the bottom half of Misfits Academy's jungle. And just look at the minimap right now. You can see the entire bottom half of that map is littered with blue wards, which means the Kingwin have full control. They know exactly where Pride Stalker is and how safe it is to take that objective. So it was safe because they had bot lane pushing in, they had mid lane pushing in, they had full vision control, and they were able to take the Drake cleanly without any sort of contestion. Because if Misfits were to contest, you're going into a level 8 Lee Sin, who has an item advantage, the TP on Ice Bisto. It would have been so easy for Kingwin to respond. And this is the difference from week 1 to 2, because in week 1, when we looked at Kingwin, their ability to set up for these objectives wasn't good, and they ended up getting punished for it.
Jisoo just cosplaying as a construction worker there. He needs to be near the tower at all times. Just like, just gonna stand here. It's fine, we'll let the lane push into me. And this, as much as we say, you know, Camille's incredibly strong, she can push the lane, she can pressure this Shen. If Jisoo just sits under his tower, is there actually much that Kingwin can do?
Well, they're slowly getting chip damage onto the tower, right? So as long as you have constant push priority, what that means is that the minion wave is always going to hit the tower, okay? So that might not seem like much, but over time, especially with cannon minion waves, that damage just stacks up. And you can see that the tower, now at about 50%, just means that Tabasco can look to make a roaming top. You can even rotate your bottom up to the top lane. It becomes so much easier to take that tower if you're always the one that's pushing. And the fact that Ice Beast still might not be killing the Shen doesn't really matter because of the pressure that you gain.
You were talking about vision control a second ago, and it feels to me like Kingwin have really stepped up their game this week, because once again, they gain vision control around red side jungle, and with Rift Herald up, that's always a possibility when you've got someone like a Camille as a split push role. They set up vision here, maybe they steal away the red, maybe they just set up a couple of ganks, but it's smart, it's cognizant play here by Kingwin. It's not just trying to make the play, it's understanding what you need to set it up.
Certainly is. So, praise to Team Kingwin. And that's not to say that Misfits Academy are playing badly. Right now, the big issue is the early deficit that they were forced into, right? It's Pride Stalker.
Tabasco is reading Pride Stalker like a book. Takes him down once again. 5-1 in favor of Kingwin. And all five of those kills have had Tabasco involved.
Now we see the map movement up to the top lane as Ice Beast still getting a little bit too greedy.
But this is all they need to do is pressure. Like, Jisoo can't defend against four people. Great rotation by Kingwin, understanding they haven't got any push priority in that bot lane. They can't do anything into the Varus. Let's go top and take that tower down.
Clean take. And now they can just send their bottom lane back down. They just need to then keep the pressure up. You can have Ice Beasto pressure in the top lane, make it harder for the Shen to teleport out, because if he does, Ice Beasto then has a direct line onto your tier 2 in the mid lane. They also have the option of rotating mid, you can see, as Koskyu gets hooked up.
Curtains are open. Koskyu takes one shot, dodges out the second two. Once again, it doesn't really matter how many land. Of course, you want them all there, but it's forcing COSQ back, and the chip damage is slowly wearing away at that mid lane tower. Misfits do come up. They're trying to react. Ice Beastow wants to kill, though. Flash away by Dreams. He is safe for the moment, but I'm pretty sure Misfits Academy don't feel safe anywhere on this map. Maybe in their base. Maybe at Fountain at the moment
perhaps.
They feel safe.
And Jisoo's feeling pretty safe right now because he knows that Ice Beastow is nowhere near his lane. He has hit that level 11 mark, which means he'll get 2 points in his ultimate. So he has a little bit of extra ability to come and save the team, should they need. But I like what Kingwin are doing right now, setting up the 1-3-1. They're going to move Corki up to the top lane, and right now I don't think he has the package. But he has the turret safety, right? So he can just clear out the waves, he can push it, and then he can move back to the safety of his turret. He's still topside so that he can get himself the blue, and he has enough mana to wave clear. You can put Camille down in the bottom lane to force the 1v1 again and create another situation to what happened earlier on in the game. And then you have the dual lane of Kingwin sitting in the mid lane, just applying pressure. Now, if you are Misfits Academy, you have to look at ways and how you can come back, right? And what you have to remember is that they have good scaling opportunities. Ryze, fantastic, come the mid and late game. Once he's got that fully stacked tier, Rod of Ages is going to take a little bit of time to stack up. Yuki going for that full Lethali build so that they have a lot of that mid-game spike as well. And if you look to play around Ice Beastow using the Shen, there are windows of opportunity that you can take advantage of. The problem for Misfits is that every time they try to make a map movement play, they end up getting punished macro-wise.
Turret doesn't go down, and D-Lord actually caught with the chains. Wild Growth used. Here comes Dreams and Pridestalker. Misfits trying to collapse. Sebex has to flash. Pridestalker jumps in. Caught up, though. Here comes the TP. Yuki already gets one. Kingwin flash away. Here comes Camille. Ice Beastow jumps onto Pridestalker. Stand United saves him for the moment. Beastow flashes. Tabasco in, though. He's unstoppable. And Kingwin trade it one for one. They don't get mid lane tower, and the priority in mid goes to Misfits.
Misfits respond to the aggression mid lane of from Team Kingwin, and they get themselves a kill, which is so desperately needed right now. Gonna be difficult for them to get a turret with Jin still alive, but the poke pressure from Misfits Academy should be enough to force Team Kingwin back, and they may very well be able to get themselves their first turret of the game. So good response from Misfits to at least claw something back for what was turning into a very dire situation.
It felt for a moment like Misfits had been a little bit slow as well, because they all went bot, and they were looking for that turret. Kingwin went for that mid lane tower, and look at the HP that's remaining.
I like the movement from Shen as well. He was already in the mid lane, realizing the play was happening bot. They get the flash taunt down onto the Lord, and Dreams and Pridestalker had already made their way towards the mid lane. So they're able to get the collapse. They know they have the numbers advantage. I feel like the teleport was very late from Ice Beastow. I think his rationale was, hey, they're going to disengage, so we don't really need to commit. And a full 5v5, you can see Ice Beastow's effectiveness falls off just a little bit, but because of how strong Tabasco is, he's at least able to claim something back in the overall exchange. So the tower is very low. Kingwin very easily able to pick it up. Net gain still goes in favor of Kingwin, but this is more of what we want to be seeing from Misfits, right? You want to see them trying to find these picks, try and force these plays, because as a team fighting unit, they actually have a lot of power.
They do. We focused a lot on jungle earlier on. Pridestalker really hasn't had the impact that we saw Kadir have in week one. It has been superb play by Tabasco, though. I think you can't take anything away from this Lee. Even in that fight, able to pick off a member, make it an even trade between the two teams. So I feel this is more Tabasco playing incredibly well rather than Pridestalker being a weak link on the team.
We are identifying that Pridestalker perhaps doesn't respect as much as opponents, because I think back to that early just face check into his own jungle, thinking it's safe, not having an awareness of where Lee Sin could be at the time. And that's a difficult thing to judge, because I obviously have full vision where Pridestalker doesn't. But it's one of those things that you have to kind of think about, you know, like, where could Lee Sin be on the map right now? May he have stolen my red? Ice Beastow is pushing in the top lane and committing for that dive in the mid lane, you know, going for the kill onto Sebex when you don't have full vision control over your opponent. Just very subtle things that have allowed Tabasco to get these advantages. But you really want to praise Tabasco as he forces a play onto Woolite.
Realm Warp comes in, COSQ catches Woolite. No escape for the Jhin. It's a great collapse by Misfits Academy, and that's what they need to do. We've started to see the 1-3-1 develop. Seems like Misfits were ever so slightly quicker at catching someone out.
Don't know what Woolite was even doing there, really. The dragon was gone. The mid tower is gone. There's no need for you to be walking through the river when you don't have push priority and bot. free kill over to Misfits, and now we're seeing a bit of an objective clash with Team Kingling because, oh, hey, we've got top lane tower, we've got mid lane tower. Now what do they go for, right? The next clear objective is the tier one in the bottom lane. What Misfits Academy have done is they've actually put the Ryze into the Camille, which is now making things difficult for Ice Beasto because he can't match the wave clear that Coscu is throwing out. And he's actually very aware of the amount of vision control. And this is the awareness we were talking just about. And Ice Beasto is responding very nicely to it.
Flash hook dreams. That's a minion, my man. It's not what you want to be grabbing in. It does get him a little bit of gold, though, you know?
It's about sending a message.
What, to the minions? I'm pretty sure they got that message about a trillion kills ago.
To Ice Beasto saying,
I could have done it if I wanted to.
I could have.
Could have threaded the needle.
But instead, I chose to hit a minion. I'm watching you.
It's also saying, you know, minions are worth more than I think you are at this time. But let's talk about Coscu into Ice Beasto, because you said it was smart play. You know, they've got great wave clear. Ice Beasto does have the Tiamat. He's also got that Trinity Force completed. Can he itemize to deal with the Ryze? Can you go Hextrinker more on Camille?
You definitely can. I think it's more important that you get the Ravenous Hydra because that adds to your wave clear, which will naturally make the lane easier. And because he is level 12, and thanks to his passive in particular, that will enable him to trade very nicely with the Ryze. So it's not like it's a bad matchup, it's just Coscu comes in, clears the wave, leaves, right? Which makes it difficult for Ice Beasto to put pressure onto this tower. But Kingwin are now doing the right thing. They've sent Camille back to the top lane, and they've moved their bottom lane to the bottom half of the map to pressure in on Jisoo, who doesn't have the wave clear. So it's all about trying to send your wave clear into the non-wave clear so that it makes it easier to set up for these towers. But now Misfits looking for a collapse.
Exactly what you have to do. If you lose an objective on one side of the map, you have to go to the other side and try and get something out of it. But
Camille,
she's so safe. She's so safe. Jisoo, however, might not be. Will I and D-Lord, we're looking for it. Just a bit of poke damage, just a bit of chip damage onto the Shen.
But now Team Kingwin know that all of Misfits Academy are on the top half of the map, so they can just keep pushing bottom. They don't need the vision. They can just push this underneath the tower to get it pushing back in their favor. Good awareness from Team Kingwin. But then, like, they know they can't commit because then they lose vision. So it's just one of these things we want to highlight that is improving in Challenger. Because the thing about Challenger in the past is it's very much always been about, let's fight, let's get lane dominance, let's look for plays. And it's nice to see more playing around vision, utilizing the fact that, hey, we can push now, we can't push now, how to better take advantage of turrets. And especially for Team Kingwin, who we didn't see this at all from last week because of how handily they got crushed by Shalka.
It's a lot more intellectual play. It's thinking about exactly why you can do something rather than if you can do it. We are about 20 minutes in now, and Kingwin, it's been all them thus far in this game. Three turrets already, that first line of objectives are down. They've taken two dragons as well, the ocean and the cloud for them. What is it that Misfits do now? How do you react to this now that your first line of towers is down?
You just wait. You have good scaling. You know you have a good team fight composition. Your ability to poke with the virus is very potent. You have a lot of pick potential with the Thrash plus Kha'Zix and Shen combo. You can set up flanks with the Realm Warp. There are lots of options for Misfits Academy. The important thing for them right now is that they don't give away any more big leads, especially if they're able to catch players like Woolite out of position as they try to get vision control. And I like this roaming duo of Dreams and Pridestalker. Always moving together as a unit reminds me very much of a similar playstyle that we saw between Ignar and Kakao, right? Where they're always moving as a unit, looking to get deep vision in, try and find picks. And so far, it worked by them catching out Woolite. They've got good vision control over topside. And now Kingwin are being forced to play more reserved and giving up a lot of the pressure that they had earlier.
And they're going to lose their first objective as well. Top lane tower is the target here for Misfits. Attempted reaction by Kingwin, but it's just a little bit too late for them. Coscu takes it, takes the passage out. And Misfits get themselves on the board. It's only a 2,000 gold lead. You have to look at it and say, Kingwin could be further ahead. They could be further ahead, 36,000 to 38. A lot of those kills sitting on Tabasco as well, which sometimes is a worry. You know, Lee Sin, very early game, very strong. Later game, having those extra kills on him doesn't do as much as if it were on Camille or on the Jhin.
Well, I mean, if he hit a virus in the face, he'd stop.
Yeah, well, yes. But true.
You are quite right in terms of Lee Sin's late game potential. He doesn't really build full tank, and he can get pretty squishy. But he probably won't go full damage either. He's that sort of hybrid off tank that loses a lot of value as the game goes on. A lot of the gold difference is actually coming out from towers, and now that Misfits Academy feel a little bit more confident, they're willing to contest his dragon.
Realm Warp in, Ice Beasto is still on the top side of the map. It's once again a cloud, but we see seen a lot of roaming around the map. Both of these teams will want it. The curtain comes down. Here goes Tabasco once again in on towards the dragon. Coscu there. Tabasco smites it. They force Pride Stalker away, and there's no smite for Misfits Academy, which means Kingren get the cloud.
Coscu just helping Tabasco clear the dragon for some reason. I understand why Misfits wanted to disengage. The Jhin ultimate acting as a good deterrent. I'm just a little bit surprised that Coscu would use his rotation to actually chunk the dragon down to just then give a free smite as we see Yuki miss his ultimate.
Ice Beasto did teleport into that fight as well, so the flank potential was there. It was a little bit threatening for them. In Picks and Bans, we talked a lot about 1-3-1 and 1-4, how Kingren can play out this game as it progresses. Misfits Academy are starting to scale up. You know, they're starting to get a few items under their belts. Are Kingren always going to be able to continue with this split push, or is there going to become a point where Misfits are just able to contest it?
Well, you have to remember that late game Camille is not someone that you can actually split push against.
I haven't seen that much late game Camille. Usually games are over by about 25 minutes.
Once she gets 2-3 items under her belt, Shen can't stop her. There is no way that you'll be able to out-trade her. I find it fascinating that Kingren are actually grouping up as a 5-man unit because this is somewhat what Misfits want to then force the 5v5 where Varus and Ryze can have a much more of a bigger impact. But regardless, they just get a bit of poke damage down onto the turret. Kingren, they have the ability to set up what I believe should be a 4-1, right? So you have the Camille go off to a side lane, you set up a slow push in the top lane, and then you act what is effectively a 1-3-1, but you're using minions rather than a player. And then you have the Corki Jhin as a really good siege tool in the mid lane. The risk you have with that is Misfits using the Realm Warp to go for a flank, Thresh landing a hook to get a pick. There are very subtle things that could be used to punish the 3-man squad or the 4-man squad that's setting up a push in mid lane. But that's what I'd like to see from Kingren. If you're Misfits, you just want to keep grouping up. You want to force Kingren to group together so that you can have enough time to farm up and get to a point where you are the stronger team fighting. And right now, they're actually getting to a good position where their 5v5 would actually be very potent right now. It's just difficult for them to actually force these plays because of Ice Beasto in the side lane. Kingren can just disengage, right? You can just allow Ice Beasto to take a turret, and maybe you lose your tier 1 in the mid, but you gain a tier 2 in the bottom. And because of all of the map control the Misfits lost early on, that's why we're seeing it being difficult for them to actually push back against Kingren.
We're starting to see vision contest around Baron. You know, it's always an objective as you get later on into the game, but I want to just come back to Kingren's vision because it's a lot weaker than it was early game. When they had a specific objective in mind, you know, the dragons early on, they had great vision control. Actually, Realm Warp here on towards Ice Beast, so he flashes away. Coscu flashes back in though, gets the Rune Prison. Here's the Stand United in as well. Wall jump, grapple away. Ice Beast trying to retreat, goes back into the Redemption. The rest of his team is coming down river and he might be able to keep himself alive for the moment. Warlike came in with a heal, but wasn't there in time and now needs to be careful because Coscu and Jisoo can turn on this. Sebex on his way. The Corki jumps in with the Valkyrie onto Coscu. They're still almost full HP. Coscu and Jisoo just 2v5ing and Misfits Academy react. It's a triple for Coscu. Kingren fall to pieces.
No idea why Kingren tried to save the Camille. The whole point of a split pusher is to draw multiple members from Misfits away from your main pushing unit so that you can then set up for an easier push. Now Tabasco, he's the one that's in trouble.
Oh, Jisoo doesn't land the taunt. Here comes the hook flash away though by Tabasco. Baron on the card, so you can see Misfits thinking about it. They pinged it a couple of times. Tabasco can steal. We saw Kadir do it for Misfits Academy time and time again last week. Can Tabasco do it for Kingren and keep some hope for them in this game? Pride Stalker is low, 2000 HP on that Baron Realm Warp. On towards him, 1,000 now, here's Sebex, here's Tabasco, here's the smite!
Oh my god!
Sebex steals it, you absolute monster! Kingren, hold on to hope in this game!
Kingren are able to get themselves the Baron in what could have been a huge swing for Misfits Academy, get upset by Sebex coming in from the flank and taking it with a basic combo of Corki. Unbelievable that Kingren are able to get that objective and walk away with only the loss of Tabasco.
Misfits played it right as well. Sonic Wave came in, they stopped. It's like, no, we're not going to go for Baron. They went through it again. Let's just have a look at exactly how this went down.
Misfits Academy don't necessarily do very much wrong here. They're just trying to zone away Tabasco. Look, His Q is now down, right? They realize that there's still the possibility for him to come in. Realm Warp is used to zone him away. The moment he Blast Cones in, they just burst him down, turn their attention onto the Baron. But then because it got down to 200 HP from the fairly early smite from Brightstalker, Sebex is able to pick up the kill. I feel like that the reason for the early smite from Pridestalker is he thought Tabasco's going to come in smite. I'll smite after he uses his smite. That'll be enough to get the kill. There's no way that Sebex can then steal it. But on 200 HP, when Sebex just throws out his Phosphorus Bomb, his Machine Gun, just uses his combo with the Sheen proc as well, that's more than enough damage to steal the Baron. He literally just walked in and walked out.
Misfits Academy and Baron Steel just seem to be synonymous at the moment. It happens every game. Here comes the curtain call looking for Yuki. Brightstalker, the new intended recipient of some of those bullets, but Baron buff minions mean King Green can just push in. The Realm Warp comes down, but in the end of the day, Koski would have been putting himself in the midst of all of King Green. Ice Beast though splitting in the bot lane, and Jisoo is not reacting to this. He's saying, I want to just get turrets, I want to get objectives, I'll stay on the other side of the map.
This is fine for Team Kingman. They know they have the Baron. They know they're going to win out on this with Camille in the bot lane as well. Who's going to answer? I feel that Jisoo needs to come back to base pretty soon because, sure, you might get a tier 2, but you could lose a lot more.
He has got Stand United, but Baron minions do even more chip damage than those normal minions. And of course, those cannons can just stand outside of range of those towers. Hook onto Tabasco, Flay comes down as well, turret down in the bottom top lane, but Dreams now jumped on by Ice Beast though. It's another kill for Kinguin, still the split push continues. Jisoo did use Stand United there, but the Inhibitor Tower falls, Redemption here as well to heal Kinguin back up. A couple of Grievous Wounds there means the healing isn't quite as strong. Jisoo continues to push in that top lane. He's going for the Inhibitor Tower, and actually Kinguin do not get the Inhibitor, and Jisoo might get this tower.
Now the three-man defense from Misfits Academy could actually be enough.
Oh, Ice-Beast though stopped on his retreat. I think Jisoo can just get this. He's stopped because Warlight's gone back. Ice-Beast though killed by Pridestalker, who continues going for the chase. There's no Realm Warp for Koski, which means they cannot go any deeper. Jisoo's just like, wait, who gives the monkeys about towers? I'm just Shen. Warlight there has got the Edge of Night, that shield protecting him from the taunt. Ocean Drake down as well for Misfits. This game has felt very messy in the last couple of minutes.
Now, I was critical of Jisoo, but he had a lot more faith in his team than I did with their ability to actually defend the Inhibitor and push back Kinguin as Koski flashes.
Flashes straight onto Warlight. The taunt doesn't land though, and Warlight escapes. He opens up the curtain. He wants an encore. He's looking just to clear out the wave. Jisoo kicked back off towards the side. He's dead. Misfits lose one. They don't take the tower. And once again, Kinguin can look to push down this middle lane.
Greedy for Misfits to go for the dive. They should have respected the possibility of Kinguin getting the turnaround, especially when there's no big minion wave for Misfits to rely on, and an incoming minion wave from Team Kinguin, and the fact that Kinguin actually still had a lot of their summoner spells available. This could very well cost them an inhibitor, and while I was praising them for their ability to actually defend and fight back, they're now just going to throw all that away.
Now back out of base with those home guards. They'll be here pretty quickly. And there's always the threat of a hook. There's always the threat that Dreams can catch someone out. Kinguin with four members will continue to siege on towards the Inhibitor, and they will eventually take it down. 30 minutes in now, and the gold is still only 4,000 between these two teams, equal on kills as well.
So we can look back at the dive. Look, there's no minion wave. It gets cleared out by just the traps from Jin, which means the Misfits Academy are sitting there tanking up the turret, making it difficult for them to actually follow up on Jisoo's engage. It's hard to get the collapse onto Warlight because he's back towards his tier 2. The rest of Team Kingman respond, especially with a Lulu. I feel like the whole dive was just very greedy, irresponsible to Misfits Academy to go for it. They could have just chipped him down, slowly worked their way on it. They'd already forced the flash out of Warlight. That would have been more than enough. And then they could have looked to take that objective. So Misfits Academy, a couple question marks. But it's a tough one, right? Because they were put behind early. They've been struggling to come back. They've done a good job of stalling out. Haven't really forced too many plays. Been forcing Kingman to group up a lot, actually, which is very much more of what their composition wanted. And then they go for this Baron play, which the play itself was wrong. Just at the very last second, just a little bit too preemptive. Perhaps the nerves just got to Pridestalker right at the end. And then that's just given freedom to Kingman. And then again, Misfits playing well, doing a good job, surprising me, in particular with the Shen commitment to the top lane. But then again, just being a little bit too greedy, going for something that they couldn't do. And it makes you think about the difference now between Pride Stalker and Kadir? Was it Kadir that was making those calls to go for these plays, to set up for these objectives? And how is Pride Stalker fitting into that role?
Sweepers used here by Misfits, trying to clear out that red side jungle. Vision gained once again by Kungun, not as much as they'd like. And actually, Jisoo stayed in that top bush for a long time, so he's got flank potential here. Kungun will collapse onto Jisoo first, teleport in by Ice Beast, so straight away, but he's going to be behind the entirety of Misfits if he completes that. He stops. Jisoo caught out, though, with the deadly flourish, and the Shen is down. Kungun can continue to look for the fight. Tabasco hooked in. Turret falls in bottom lane. The inhibitor is the next target. Here comes the curtain call. Pride Stalker in the front line. He's down. Kungun continuing just to take this fight as Ice Beasto continuing to take objectives. Kozku low, hook from Dreams though, and Woolite tries to get onto the kill onto Kozku, can't quite manage it. The Nexus is the target here for Ice Beasto though, he's going for those Nexus towers, and he might get one before Misfits can react. D-Lord just distracting, first Nexus tower down. I now think Ice Beasto needs to back away. It's a little bit of an overcommit if he continues to stay.
He's going to go for it, though. Kozku has now made it back to base. Note that Dreams is still yet to return. 1v2 for Beasto.
He'll get the Nexus Tower, and he'll get out as well. Great play by Beasto, confident in his ability to dodge away from the Ryze, and he gets so much.
Now, you can see Misfits Academy try to force the fight. The 5v4, this is the point in the game where they want to try and go for this sort of a play. The TP comes in from Ice Beasto, but then the immediate disengage from Misfits Academy think, oh no, we can't because that flank is going to ruin us. But that actually means that the four-man unit just leave Jisoo out to dry. They're able to trade one for one overall, and the good disengage, the good kiting from Kingman where they just move in between the minion wave using their long-range harass to win out on this fight is looking very favorable for them, but then Sebex just gets caught out here. Good hook from Dreams to capitalize on this. Woolite thinks that he can get the kill onto Kozku, gets baited into the minions as well as Yuki, and then they're able to get the turnaround, but they lost so much of their base in exchange.
D-Lord did a great job after that replay ended, actually just distracting and delaying the backs. So they got two Nexus Towers because of it. If Kozku had got back in time, they wouldn't have been able to get all of those objectives. And now Baron's on the cards once again, and really, this feels pretty much like it should be Kingwin's. They've started it up. Pride Stalker's just around the corner. Maybe we'll see another steal. Tabasco trying to just keep him away from this objective. Blast cone used, knocks him away. Baron has been disengaged though. Ice Beasto jumps in onto Kozku. Stand United being used. Kozku isolated, still alive somehow in the backline. The curtain call comes down from Woolite. He's trying to snipe. He can't quite land the shots. Misfits Academy are able to stop the push and stop the Baron.
But now Kingwin can just move straight back to it because now Kozku, with no summoners, no realm warp, and nowhere to be seen, there are very little answers the Misfits Academy have to stop Kingwin taking this Baron.
Yeah, Baron goes down, and you have to feel this is the beginning of the end for Misfits Academy. They lost two Nexus Towers, they don't have any defenses on their Nexus, only one inhibitor and one turret remains for them on the entirety of Summoner's Rift. And If you just looked at the gold differences, if you just looked at the kill differences, you'd think this was a very even game. I mean, 6,000 gold at this point isn't massive. However, the way that Kingwin have been able to take objectives with cross-map plays has been phenomenal.
Certainly has. And a lot of that comes down to this Camille pick. We wondered why it was let through. We wondered whether or not Misfits Academy would have an answer to it. And the fact that Ice Beasto was able to get himself that double buff level one is really where the pressure started for Misfits Academy. They have had no ability to stop Ice Beasto in the side lane. They went for that early collapse, which Kingwin responded to horribly. But rather than just pushing, they tried to save their top laner. They end up all dying for it, but it still doesn't result in a ban for Misfits Academy. It has indeed been a very messy game, but now Kingwin should be able to clean things out pretty easily.
Looking for the final tower on the map. To be able to take this one pretty easily, as you say. Hook just doesn't quite connect. They do take the tower. Ice Beasto still in the bottom lane. Jisoo there as well. Kingwin will back away for the moment. Disengage. They're happy just to wait this one out. Mid lane inhibitor has respawned though, so perhaps very minute signs of hope. Ice Beasto jumps in onto Jisoo. He's incredibly tanky though on that Shen, and he doesn't want the trade for the time being.
I feel that if you're Ice Beasto, you should actually move mid. Okay, this also works. You don't have a minion wave if you're Kingwin in the top lane, so just make the rotation to mid lane. You don't need a minion wave because there's only an inhibitor there, so you can just slowly work your way onto it. But you can't take advantage of the Baron empowered minions that help you so much in being able to take away these towers. So it's going to be a little bit slow. I feel that you could send Corki up there maybe to just keep the push going. Kingwin, just ever so slight criticism with their ability to close out. Here comes the ult.
Curtain call comes down. Kozku looking for the flank play onto Woolite. Yolt hasn't really done a huge amount, but catches Pride Stalker with the last shot, and now they can continue to look for the inhibitor. Hook, Tabasco isn't the target you want. Ice Bisto's gone on to Jisoo as well. He's taken him down to half HP. It's only the Nexus here for Misfits Academy, the last remaining structure. Koskyu tries to get the kill off towards the side. Dreams caught out with a deadly burst. Pride Stalker trying to do something, trying to salvage something, but there's nothing he can do as Kinguin take the Nexus.
Good game from Kinguin overall. Impressive performance, I feel. I think it's fair to say that their early game was much better. Their ability to play around vision, their ability to set up for objectives was good. Nice to see an improvement from Tabasco from week one to week two, where we were
massive
like,
improvement.
Who is yeah. this Tabasco in week one? But then when he gets his hands on the Lee Sin, he seems a lot more comfortable. Definitely helps that Camille got a double buff at level one, enabled a lot of the early snowballing from Team Kinguin. Want to give some props to Misfits Academy because I felt that there were a lot of things that they did right, and they actually punished Kinguin very rightly so for the way in which they responded to the plays from Misfits Academy, but they just weren't quite able to close things out. Their setup around the Baron, just a preemptive smite from Pride Stalker, the way in which they tried to respond to a lot of these situations were just unfortunate because of how far behind they were. But you can't take anything away from Team Kinguin. The fact that they were able to get the Baron steal, the fact they were able to get two Barons in total, and the way they just played the overall game, good stuff.
Very good stuff from them all around. Their objective play was strong. I think the question for me now comes down to, if you don't give a double buff to Camille at level 4, if you don't give them Camille, do they play that cleanly next game? Is it all because they were ahead and they, you know, you have better shot calls when you're ahead, you feel a lot more confident in your plays? Or is it because they actually have worked out how to play as a unit and how to play as a team?
That's it. Exactly right. Because when we look back at last week, this was not the Team Kinguin that we saw. This could have just been a good game or a bad game from Misfits Academy. Either way, they're going to have another opportunity to prove themselves as Misfits Academy will now look to recollect because their perfect record of the 2-0 from week one has now been blemished. And Team Kinguin looking to make their way up onto the scoreboard. So I'm excited to see what both teams bring out in game two.
Misfits Academy have a history of being quite a late game team. Like I think they've had the two longest games in week one, and then this game was relatively long as well. Is there a weakness for them there? Are they playing too many of these scaling comps?
They very well do. I mean, from what we've seen so far, Pride Stalker, not the best at setting up those early objectives, so maybe put him on something more scaling and punish the fact that Tabasco taking not the most aggressive early jungle paths.
Well, coming up, we have game two between Team Kinguin and Misfits Academy. Don't go anywhere.